So what we said so far is that K is a matrix for the numerator that has root squares of both divided by this. And what we want to do is now that I want to make a particular choice of x d. So this is this expression is true in general for any two arbitrary, you know, what do you call vector fields. But now I want to do what I want to take x small x, that is basically the parameterization of the surface or the part of the surface. And I'm taking x as x u and y as y u. And I know that my EFGs are basically this. Okay? And my E is x u dot n and f is x u v dot n, so on and so forth. And that's what I would like to basically, using these I would like to compute this k. So what is the first quantity that we need to compute? It's basically this Lx and y. Next, Lxx. So this is what that we would like to compute. But what is Lx? The gradient? Okay. By the way, even the self-adjointness would not give us any help actually. Think about it. So we were assuming the covariant derivative to be self-adjoint. But in the covariant derivative, we have this a similar kind of an identity. So we have, in fact, yes, we have. So this would be, here's the thing. So this is going to be del x. Okay, so it's like a directional derivative of the normal vector in the direction of x in the product with x actually. Okay? Now, if you see the proof of theorem 4.22, okay, there we basically, using the compatibility of the metric, we derive this identity. So what is that? That if you have minus del x y minus del x n and y, okay? So it's like we have the covariant derivative of the normal vector in the direction of x and its inner product with y, then this is same as computing n. This is equal to n and the inner product of x and the directional derivative of y in the direction of x. We have the covariant derivative of y in the direction of x. So this is the identity that we proved basically while we were proving that L is a self-adjoint operator. So if we assume this identity, or take this identity, then this above expression, so in other words, this Lxx is basically n and del xx. Okay? So in particular, if I take x to be x, so this would be del xu xu, and if we for now we say that okay, this is del xu u xu u, okay, then this is nothing, this is just here. Okay, so you got what would be, for example, this lx and y. We can break it down to something similar. So it's like, okay, so repeating the same set of steps, you can get n and del, okay, x, v, x, u, okay, so covariant derivative of x, v in the direction of x, u, okay, and then we can treat this as x, u, v. And which is same as g. We don't have any other choice. This has to be true. Okay? And sir, this is the case. I'm sorry.
It will be true. When we are computing xv is basically a vector. and we are applying the gradient operator over that.
It's not a gradient operator, covariant
derivative.
Covariant derivative operator has a definition. That's what the key thing is, that to ensure that, you know, the thing that you're doing is true. Okay. So let's take it for now, and then, you know, we're gonna just advance. So once you have this, you know, you almost have it basically. So what would be your K? So what? Similarly, you can compute, okay, Ly and Y.
So that is F.
This is F.
Yes.
So this is Y. So what would be Ly and Y?
It would be so.
So it must be
N X V V.
Dot product of N.
N X
X V V.
X V V at. So this is nothing
G.
But G. So if you have it, then you have this x actually, and think about it. So what was the first component in the determinant? The first component was Lx x actually, so this is your E. And the second component was Lx y, so it's F. And this must be F as well, and this must be G. What is x dotted with x? So
capital E.
So it's capital E, okay? And X U dotted with X, because we have X, capital X dotted with Y, so it's going to be capital F, and similarly capital F and G. And that's it. That's what is basically essentially your
EG
minus F squared, and similarly also EG minus F squared. Okay? So this is what is basically Gaussian curvature. And then Lx and the product of y and y and what?
And y.
Okay, so
yx.
Yx.
Bd.
Okay, so in the case yx. Okay. Gaussian and the mean curvature in the terms of, in terms of what? In the terms of the first and second conventional format. So this is what the effect that we kind of deduce. By the way, if you see the formula for the mean curvature, curvature is zero. Okay. The mean curvature would be zero. In other words, if and only if the numerator, okay, in the formula, okay, would be zero. Actually, are you getting the point? So in other words, if you want to show that a surface is a minimal surface, just show that this guy,
eg,
e small g minus 2ff plus small eg is equal to 0. Okay? So if you can show that the first and second fundamental form satisfy this identity, okay, then the mean curvature is 0 and hence your surface is a minimal surface. Okay? This is what is basically one of the examples. I'm sorry? So, I gave you an example last time. So, okay, your sword flips are an example of a minimal surface. Okay, so when we were kids, still doing, with the kids actually, that, take this soapy water, okay, and a cross section of a circle, and you dip that into the water and give it a blow. So you're gonna get the bubbles coming out of it. Okay. So imagine the surface giving, imagine the surface in the cross section, the circular cross section, before giving it a blow. So that's a minimal surface actually. Okay? A surface that is formed by bubble surface. So it has a tendency that it wants to, just stay where it is actually. So don't want to stretch too much. Are you getting the point? Or you can also assume. So the different kind of bubbles are the surfaces which have a tendency to shrink actually. Okay, so they don't want to expand too much. Okay. So the soap films are the good examples. So anything that you can make out of the soap films, most of the time they are going to be what do you call minimal surfaces. Okay. So the calculation in one lecture, so if you have to take a surface and compute its Gaussian mean and curvature, and what would be, when Gaussian map and Gauss map, so we want to do this in one simple lecture actually. Okay. So let's just do a bit of theoretical things first. So this result is basically very simple result. Okay, it's due to the Euler. Essentially, tells you that how you can express the second fundamental form purely in the terms of the principal curvature section. So in other words, you can determine the second fundamental form, in the terms of what you call principal curvatures. But it's not much counterintuitive, because think about it. So if you compute the principal curvatures, okay, using first and second fundamental form, then there must be a way to express these forms in the terms of the principal curvature essentially. So should be something intuitive. So the theorem is this, that if x1 and x2 are the eigenvalues, eigenvectors of this shape operator L, the Lingard map L, and x is a vector field of this kind, cos theta x1 plus sin theta x2, something like that, then the second fundamental form for such a vector field x can be computed as k1 cos square theta plus k2 sine squared theta, okay. Sine squared theta. Okay. So in other words, these are two basic eigenvectors, and x is a vector in the terms of these vectors actually. So,
So in which case roughly they are the bases?
They are kind of bases.